News 46. Local coverage you can count on.
Hi, I'm Gary Neff, owner of Jewelry of Romance, located at 351 Frontage Road, across from Walmart. We're starting our 14th year in December of servicing Pahrump as our hometown jeweler. We have fantastic sales for the holiday season. We have our musical clocks at 40% off, our watches, all watches at 40% off, and our jewelry is 25% off. God bless, come in and see us, and Merry Christmas!
Pahrump's most watched and number one media source for local news and weather with Deanna O'Donnell.
Welcome to News 46's Week in Review, your number one source for local news. I'm Deanna O'Donnell.
And I'm Zach Fuentes for News 46. Ammonix Incorporated, which has a North Las Vegas solar array manufacturing plant, said its CEO was killed in a plane crash in Pennsylvania.
38-year-old Brian Robertson was the lone occupant of a twin-engine plane that crashed in a field. A flight plan indicated Robertson was flying from Long Beach, California, to York, Pennsylvania, near the crash site. The cause of the crash is still under investigation. Robertson was reportedly flying to Pennsylvania to visit family for the holidays when he was killed. Robertson is a longtime executive in the solar industry and an avid pilot. He is survived by his wife and three children. In May, Robertson was joined by Governor Brian Sandoval and other dignitaries in opening the company's North Las Vegas plant, a joint venture with Singapore company Flextronics that brought more than 300 jobs to the city. Ammonix is North America's largest solar services provider. Governor Sandoval and Senator Harry Reid have made statements sending condolences in the loss of Brian Robertson. This is Deanna O'Donnell for News 46. And on April 24, 2008, Kelvin Owens murdered Bridget Vavanese on the south end of town by shooting the mother of two and grandmother of one in the head, then shooting himself in the mouth, dislodging a tooth that went through his eye. Kelvin Owens was treated for his injuries while Bridget lost her life. In Judge Lane's courtroom, Kelvin was sentenced to 10 years to life for his crime. April 24th of 2008, Bridget Vavanese lost her life just 3 days before her 50th birthday on Thousand Air. Kelvin Owens took her life tragically. We're going to speak to some of her family members at the sentencing hearing today in Judge Lane's courtroom.
Well, I'm actually, it's the best we could get, so it's life with probation after 10 years, and that's the next best thing to a first-degree murder conviction we could get, so I'm happy with what the judge and the district attorney did. They really worked hard on the case, and that's the best we could come out with it.
I feel great. I feel like the last day of high school. It is awesome. We got life in prison, possibility of parole after 10 years with credit for time served. In all honesty, yeah, I might have to go back up and fight the parole board in 6.5 years, but this man, no parole board will put him on the street. This man's done. He'll never ride in a taxi again. He'll never go drink at a bar with his buddies. He'll never go home for a family reunion. Not that he even would, but you know, now he can't. And I just love that. And I never have to worry about, there's no date. That's what's beautiful. There's no date, August 12th, you know, 2025 or nothing like that, that he's going to get out. And I love that.
She was awesome. She was always there for us, you know. Doesn't matter through thick and thin. She was just there. She was an amazing person. She always gave to everybody, took care of animals. I mean, like, she'd give you the shirt off her back. It doesn't matter who you were.
And I know that you've had a tragic 3.5 years, all from April of, I believe it was 2008.
Correct. We've just had family members that were lost to cancer, and I mean, just everything that you can think of has happened to us. But her murder was, it was stolen. I mean, her life was stolen. Everything was stolen from us. It wasn't a tragedy that happened. It was a choice that was made that happened. And that's exactly what it is that this man has made repeated choices that cost people everything, and he just doesn't care.
People know sisters' relationships and how close sisters are. To lose your sister must be devastating.
Yeah, I'm an orphan. My mom's dead, my dad's dead, my sister. Well, I never, in a million years, you don't think that's going to happen to you. And we all sent letters to the judge, and I expressed that in the letter to the judge, you know. I know, I'm sure he's read thousands of those letters, but I never thought I was going to write a letter like that, you know.
When you look at Bridget's children and grandchildren, do you see her?
Oh, absolutely. And my youngest daughter looks just like her, and my youngest daughter's daughter looks just like her. So we can't escape her, and that's wonderful to me, you know, but it's painful. I write to her every day. There's not one day, literally, that goes by that I don't sob at some point. Either have to pull the car over or just can't leave the room.
You speak to her? You talk to her? Do you feel her?
Yeah, I do. A lot.
So tired of the straight line, and everywhere you turn, there's vultures and thieves at your back. The storm keeps on twisting, keep on building lies.
To view the extended interviews with the family of Bridget Vavanese, go to KPVM.TV or KPVM's YouTube page.
What a tragedy. Well, this is something we don't see every day here in Pahrump. Two people walking away uninjured from a rollover automobile accident, especially as fast as this one is said to have been traveling.
Two occupants of a single vehicle rollover Saturday night luckily walked away uninjured after losing control of the vehicle on Pahrump Valley Boulevard south of Mount Charleston. The 18-year-old with her little sister, who is said to be 11, were reportedly racing home in the car that their parents bought the 18-year-old. Apparently, the girls were at the home of a boy that she has been told not to see. The young adult lost control of the vehicle, overcorrecting and rolling the car in a field west of the roadway. A witness with a dash camera recorded the entire incident, according to sources. They state that the car was traveling in excess of 80 miles per hour when it careened off the roadway. A blood draw was taken at the scene by Nye County Sheriff's deputies, though speed appears to be the only factor in this incident. Nye County Sheriffs are investigating. This is Deanne O'Donnell at Pahrump Valley Boulevard and Mount Charleston for News 46. Last Saturday at 11:33 p.m., the Clark County Fire Department responded northbound I-15 at mile marker 9. Mile marker 9 is 9 miles from the California state line between Prim and Jean. A semi-tractor trailer driver traveling northbound noticed a problem with the dual tires on his trailer and stopped. The bearings had overheated and his rear tires were on fire. The driver disconnected the tractor from the trailer and attempted to extinguish the fire, but it was too large by that time. The driver was hauling a refrigerated trailer full of yogurt. The fire was under control within 10 minutes. There were no injuries. The trailer and its contents were a total loss.
Wow. Well, Amber Maxwell was arrested in court last Monday. That now makes 6 defendants who have been charged with the murder and attempted murder that occurred on Donner Street.
31-year-old Amber Maxwell was arrested in court on Monday. She's the wife of Michael Maxwell Jr., along with 4 other defendants who have been arrested and charged with the murder and attempted murder of Michael Frazier and Antoinette Bell. The stabbing attack occurred on Donner Street on May 1st of this year. Amber Maxwell was in court attending her husband's hearing, where witnesses testified against him. She was informed of the warrant and taken into custody by a bailiff. She has been charged with attempted murder, being under the influence of a controlled substance, destroying evidence, and possession of methamphetamine. She is in custody at the Nye County Detention Center and is being held on the bail amount of $50,000 cash or $100,000 bond. The other defendants are Troy Jackson, Vicky Garcia, Tiffany Rubio, and Charles Eubanks. This is Deanne O'Donnell for News 46.
The rest of the suspects remain in custody. A trial is set for July 9, 2012. Amber Maxwell is scheduled to be in Pahrump Justice Court on January 4th.
An early morning structure fire on Stephanie Street off Bell Vista required Pahrump Valley Fire and Rescue to respond to the scene.
Early this morning, we were dispatched to report of a structure fire. The occupants were evacuating. Upon arrival, we found a fully involved manufactured dwelling that was used as a fixed structure, with extension to nearby vehicles and other personal property strewn around the yard. Crews did a really good job. We were confronted with 22, 25 mile an hour winds. Temperatures had dropped. It was a pretty severe conditions considering, but they just did a great job. There was no further extension. Fire was placed under control approximately 20 minutes after arrival.
Did we have another heroic citizen trying to put out their structure on this one too, which we've discussed in the past? Please don't do this. You're endangering yourself.
Yeah, upon arrival, we found a gentleman trying to use a garden hose, and it was well thought, but it was pretty much a futile effort considering the winds and the gallons per minute that a garden hose flows, considering the fire conditions that we experienced. So once we took care of that issue, we were able to focus again on the suppression objective.
Was this their main residence?
It was a residence on the actual property. There was actually at least two or three residences on the property. So.
So are they able to live in this structure at this point? No.
No, the it was actually a fifth wheel trailer that was converted to a fixed structure, and it was consumed in the fire.
Do we know what the cause is at this point?
Well, we're investigating it now. We're in the early stages of that. We hope to have a better idea by tomorrow.
And nobody was injured in this fire?
No injuries.
And this is not the first incident at this location. A couple of years ago, a woman died when her vehicle caught fire near this residence, and she was unable to get out of the car.
Wow. Well, still more to come with News 46's News and Review.
Harum's most watched and number one media source for local news and weather with Deanna O'Donnell.
Welcome back to News 46's Week in Review. Christine Consalia is asking for a little help to bring some Christmas joy to her kids for the holidays.
Well, I got Andrew, like I told you before, sweet kid, outgoing, doesn't really look for a lot, but kind of, you know, expects mom to make sure everything is right. So I guess I'm calling out for help. My daughter, 14, awesome kid, loves school, wants to be a psychiatrist, you know? I mean, on and on, you know? And I need help.
So I know we're so close to Christmas right now. How can we help them? Do you want monetary donations? We can get them some gifts. Should we give you a call?
You know what? Right now, I would appreciate almost anything, you know, and when I say that, I don't mean, you know, send me a stone, you know, just anything. I just need a little help. And because of the fact that I can't jot down exactly what it is that they would like, but
they're teenagers,
you know, right. What would you like?
Teenagers are hard to buy for. I know that a lot of gift certificates, a lot of electronic equipment as well. But they also are looking for some clothing.
Definitely. Definitely clothing.
What sizes are we talking about?
We have Andrew, medium built. I say pant, 25, 30. Tops, small, medium.
Yeah.
Shoes, 10.
And then Olivia?
Olivia would say 7 women's, junior women's, small tops. Nine and a half, 10.
There you go. And so a gift certificate would be great for them too as well, for Walmart or something. But if you guys can pick up these things or get them, you know, any of the electronics that the kids are going for right now. I know there's some expensive ones out there, but anything that people can help you out with, putting something underneath your tree.
That'd be a blessing. That'd be a blessing.
What's the phone number?
Telephone number is 775-910-3539.
Once again, if you would like to help Christina and her family, her number is 910-3539. That's 775-910-3539.
Well, we spoke to accused arsonist Anthony Greco about allegations that he poured mineral spirits in his soon-to-be foreclosed home and lit it on fire in order to collect on the insurance.
Yeah, the fire was discovered on August 19, 2010.
What happened on that day? You called up the Nye County Sheriff's Office to report theft or something.
Yes, what happened was I go to the house every day to do work on it, and I seen that there was a problem. I ran into the house, and there wasn't a fire. I heard water running, so I ran out to the backyard to shut off the pump and everything to stop the water from running. And I realized that somebody broke into the house. So this is actually not an arson case. This is a break-in with vandalism by fire.
So you weren't living at the residence at that time, but you said that you were remodeling it.
Yes. There's a lot of remodeling done in the house. I have pictures of everything that we did. Kathy and I had worked on the house. And then when she had to go back to Vegas for her job, I was mainly the one who was doing the work on the house.
Kathy's your girlfriend?
Yes.
You've both been charged by the state. Fire marshal has sent a report. Nye County Sheriff's Office have charged you with what?
They charged with arson, insurance fraud, and one other charge.
They're stating that the home was going into foreclosure or in foreclosure and that you were trying to collect on the insurance money.
That's totally ridiculous. The house is just about going into foreclosure now, but we had sent letters to seven different locations of Bank of America that we, because of what was going on, we did not want the house anymore. We told them as of November 1st to stop sending any kind of letters to for the mortgage or anything like that. We just, Kathy's decided that what the insurance company did, and we know the corruption in the town, she doesn't even want to stay here. After this case is over, she probably will be leaving. And it's a shame for the community. She's been an RN. She's got 29 years experience. Her background is spotless. She's a great person. And I don't care that they're coming after me, but to hurt someone like her to get to me is horrible.
So they're stating that mineral spirits were poured in the house, that you a couple days before took out your belongings, but you weren't living there, so that you took out your valuables.
We removed the stuff 3 months before to start working on the house inside. Mm-hmm. I've done tons of work on the outside of the house, and we just needed the stuff, because as I was working on house scraping ceilings, I was moving stuff from room to room, and it got ridiculous. It was a lot of labor for no reason. It would be easy for the house to be empty. As far as the house being empty the week before, that's totally false.
And you have a letter from a person that the state fire marshal called.
Yes, I do non-commercial resident agency for people that have corporations in the state. And the fire marshal called one of my customers on December 2nd, 2010, and turned around and told my customer that I was a criminal and a known felon, and he shouldn't do business with me. I've never heard of an investigation to be run like that.
And Walmart hosted Breakfast with Santa and Shop with a Cop this past weekend. Today, Walmart had their second annual breakfast. Okay. Today, Walmart had their second annual Breakfast with Santa, as well as Shop with a Cop. We are going to speak to Deborah Bozen from Walmart about this annual event.
Today, we gave some children that weren't going to have a Christmas. We gave them a $100 gift card so they could go out into the store and have something to have under their trees to open for Christmas morning.
Is this for them, or they're shopping for the family?
Well, they're shopping for themselves. Elementary school, Evie, I want to thank her because she's the one that selected the kids from the elementary schools, mm-hmm. the ones that weren't going to have a Christmas at all. And she gives me the list of the names, and I take the kids and invite them in for breakfast with Santa at Subway. I'd like to thank them for their contribution. They give the kids a free breakfast. Then they go out and shop. And we wrap the presents for them, and then they go home.
They went and shopped with a cop.
Right. They're shopping with a police officer because I want to get the community involved. I want our children to know that there are protectors out there, that there are people that they can go to if they have a problem, anything is going on in their lives in today's world. You just never know. So I think it's a good combination.
We had Pahrump Valley Fire and Rescue here, Correction Corporation of America, Nye County Sheriffs, and Nye County Emergency Services, and the Nye County Auxiliary.
Right, and we also have the Girl Scout Troop 503, mm-hmm. Number 503. Yes, Chaplain Adam Gildner is just awesome. He rounded up all of our volunteers from CCA, which was very, very nice.
It was really wonderful to see the kids out there and they're shopping. Santa, I know you got to have a little conversation with the kids and some pictures beforehand. Did they tell you what they wanted?
Yes, all of them did, actually. And we hope they get their wish.
There you go. And so Walmart does this every year now, don't they?
This is our second year. It was called something else before, and we had our associates doing it. I just wanted to involve our community more. I wanted to bring in all of our public servants so the children know that they're out there.
I can't even tell you how many people donated their time and resources for this wonderful event. So many kids walking out here with smiley faces, gifts that they would have never received this Christmas season during these hard economic times. Of course, we want to thank the Nye County Sheriff's Office, Nye County Emergency Services, Pahrump Valley Fire and Rescue, Correction Corporation of America, as well as all the other volunteers and donators to this wonderful event. This is Deanna O'Donnell at Walmart for News 46.
The Pahrump Valley Rotary placed giving trees throughout the town in order to give presents to deserving little boys and girls all over Pahrump. Last Friday night, Minnie helped Santa and his elves wrap gifts at Terrible's Lakeside.
Here at Terrible's Lakeside, this event room was filled with hundreds of gifts. The Rotarians have been wrapping all day long for Giving Day, which will be held tomorrow. We're going to speak to Julie Hargis, Lois Mead, and Barbara Thompson.
Yes, this is our gift wrapping party, getting ready for our big Giving Day event tomorrow.
And the Giving Day event is really emotional, wonderful event. Tell me what we do during that.
We give out all the gifts from the angel trees that people have, you know, volunteered and bought all the presents for. It is just heart-wrenching. You see some of these poor children that didn't get anything and the emotions that they feel and the thankfulness of everybody.
What are the giving trees, Julie?
What are the giving trees? We put the angel trees out. We put the names of the needy children on there. The angels are adopted. The presents are brought back. Tonight, we all get together with some of the members of the community. We wrap them all. And then tomorrow, we have Santa and Emil and their family comes. And we get to provide their Christmas for them.
We're here at Terrible's Lakeside. And we have so many volunteers here wrapping gifts.
We have a lot of volunteers wrapping gifts. It's just overwhelming to think that people would volunteer like this and help us out wrap all these presents. And we've got a few people that would like to say an extra special thank you to. And Julie's got the names for those.
I do. There's a new church in town, University Wisdom Church. And we had 8 kids that were not adopted. And they came and got our 8 last children, bought them some bikes and presents, and they're here helping us wrap tonight. So a special thank you to them. Pat Michaels, Chef Bill, and Lakeside. Lakeside always is our host, and they generously take care of us. So a big, big thank you to them. Our big, huge supporter this year is Tom Saida and Thomas Enos. He had so many of the angels adopted. Tom, thank you from our whole club. You've been a tremendous help in all the angel venues that people put the trees up, and it's been a very successful year. And I believe our number is 163 for the amount of children this year that we've adopted out for angel trees.
Yeah, wow, this is wonderful. Do you know about how many gifts we wrapped?
Oh, I wouldn't have a clue. Do you know about?
I would say they probably average about 8 a child.
Oh, wow. Lots of gifts.
Right. A lot.
So how can people get involved in the Rotary in the future?
Our club meets at Mountain Falls on Wednesday nights at 6 p.m. They're welcome to come by and visit us anytime. You can go by and see Barbara at American First Bank. Lois is there too. I'm down at Car Studio. We have Rotarians all over town. Certainly you can call, look up on our website and Google Pahrump Valley Rotary Club, and you can get information about what we do and about some of our members there.
Well, you just saw her in that last story. Car Studio's Julie Hargis may be able to help you with those last-minute gift ideas.
Right now, we're currently doing a Wednesday special 20% off for our senior citizens. And we also have a $15 outside special for cars. SUVs and trucks are slightly higher. And through the end of the year, which we've got a few days left, we're going to do a Christmas cleanup on your insides for $40, we will do completely the inside of your vehicle. When you're done hauling those packages and Christmas tree, come by and we can clean it up for you.
That's especially great because a lot of us don't want to do that.
That's right, and that's why we tried to make it special, kind of reward you after the Christmas holiday is over.
Exactly. There's also going to be a food drive going on. Would you like to tell us a little bit about that?
We do. We've had the first annual Harvest Food Festival, food drive, excuse me. We had that for Thanksgiving, and we were able to feed 14 families. We're continuing it through Friday, December 23rd, in a few days. We just got 9 more families given to us as names. We're working in connection with the Church of the Harvest. They're doing the distribution, but we're the drop-off point. So if you have any canned goods or anything like that, if you want to give a gift certificate to a family, we're trying to get the last few families fed for Christmas this year. So bring it on down here to Car Studio, located in front of the Nugget. Our hours right now in the winter are 9 to 4. So come on down and help. We'd really appreciate it.
That would be a very great gift for people. Do you guys offer gift certificates as well?
We do, Zach. We do have gift certificates available in any denomination. So if you have $5 left for a stocking stuffer, we can give you $5 off a detail. Whatever denomination, $5, $25, $100, whatever you want to give. We had a lady that just called us and she said her kids wanted to buy a detail for us. So I told her, come on down, have them buy it and stick it in her stocking for her, and we'll go ahead and get that done. So definitely, and they're good for 60 days. So they don't have to use it right away. Come on down to Car Studio and see us.
Love her. Well, kids got all dressed up last Friday to meet the big man himself, Santa, who stopped by McDonald's to have dinner with them.
Guess who was here at McDonald's on Friday night? None other than the big elf himself, Santa Claus. We're going to speak to manager Michael Holder.
Oh, yes. Tonight on Friday, we had Santa come visit us for all the boys and girls and grown-ups alike to come get their picture taken with Santa and eat a Happy Meal and just have a good time and enjoy the atmosphere.
Really great. They're taking pictures out there.
Oh, yes. They're all taking pictures, and we will be the ones providing the pictures tomorrow. So, I mean, great time out here. Everybody's having fun, and we're enjoying it.
The kids are really lined up for him there with all their lists all ready to go and everything, and some of them really dressed to the nines.
Oh, yes. A lot of parents brought their kids all dressed up, which is awesome. You know, it's always good to have a picture with Santa. So, you know, their first Christmas. So, I mean, it's a really good big deal for us to have Santa come to Pahrump, especially at our store. So.
It's a wonderful event. Tell a little bit about some of the specials, some of the things coming on at McDonald's right now at this time of year.
Well, we have the peppermint mocha right now, which is a really big hit. You know, we're re-hitting back the Big Mac, so, and we're getting the new cinnamon apple walnut oatmeal next week. So come down and try it out. We're going to have samples, free samples, going throughout the week, so come try it.
I know that this time of year you find yourself wanting and gravitating towards the coffee drinks and the hot cocoa drinks, and you guys seem to have a wide array of different products there.
Oh, yes. McDonald's has really done an outstanding job coming out with McCafe drinks. At number one right now in, like, all kinds, ice mochas, from frappes to lattes to God, you name it, we probably have it.
It's really true. So here at McDonald's, of course, are we 24 hours here?
24. The drive-thru is 24 hours, so, yep.
What's coming up next? Any other events coming up for the holidays for New Year's?
Well, we don't have nothing really planned yet, but, you know, like I said, if we do, you guys will be the first ones to know.
Of course, come on down here for all your McCafe drinks, and, of course, try that peppermint mocha. It's fantastic here at McDonald's. This is Deanna O'Donnell for News 46.
Desert View Hospital's marketing director, James Oscarson, has decided to run for Assembly District 36.
Deanna, we saw an opportunity. Assemblyman Goodhart has decided to move on to the Senate, so we decided to take an opportunity and see how we could do with the Assembly race in District 36.
No, he's looking for Mike McGinnis's seat that he's vacating.
Right. I believe Mike McGinnis has termed out, so he'll be running. I think there'll be some other candidates in that race. And so far, we're the first one to announce, and we're pretty happy about that and going to continue on and hopefully run a good positive campaign.
And tell me about you wanting to be in the political arena now.
I've had some opportunities in the past working with the legislators in Carson City. We've had some opportunities when I was with one of the state licensing boards and worked with LCB and some of those folks in getting bills through, and it was a very interesting process. I kind of got a taste and a flavor for it and got to work with the legislators significantly up there and some of the lobbyists, and feel like this is a good opportunity and a good time in my life for me to take advantage of this opportunity that's presented itself.
I know that you're here at Desert View Hospital. What's going to be going on with that?
My employer is extremely supportive. I've had the opportunity to visit with Susan DeVille, our CEO, and Mark Stoddard, who's the president of the corporation, and they both are very supportive, encourage me to do that, and assure me that I'll have a place when I get back from the 4 or 5 months we spend at the legislature every other year.
And about your opponent, has anybody come forward yet?
We don't have anybody that's announced yet. It's still very early, but we want to come out early and announce and starting our campaigning and doing some of the things we're going to do.
And a little bit about what are your hopes and dreams to bring to Assembly District 36?
Well, I think the rurals have been particularly hard hit in some of these economic times that have happened, and I think we need to ensure that the rurals still have a say-so and have a voice in the legislature. I think the folks who have been my predecessors have done a good job with that, and we're going to continue on and do what we can to make sure that the services that are available here are, we at least maintain them, or if not maintain them, at least try and make sure that there's a there's some continuity of things. Obviously, I have a healthcare background. It's important to me that I stress that, but it's not the only platform I have. I'm going to work on the things that the people at the state level can work on, in addition to being able to work with the people in state and local governments, the local governments here, the county commissioners in the counties that I represent, and the town boards and those folks, to ensure that the state's doing everything they can to communicate with them and keep in touch.
It's nice to have somebody representing us from Pahrump here and to go on to be assemblyman. What are you hearing from the public right now?
You know, everything so far has been very positive. People that know me know that I listen. It's a very steep learning curve, and I'm learning things, new things every day. Had the opportunity to meet with some of the assemblymen that are already there and have been there a while, and they're giving me their input and their thoughts. And I think the key is to listen to the constituents. They're the ones who put you there, and they're the ones who keep you there if they like what you do. So if you listen to what they're saying, if you pay attention, you're not always going to be able to do what they want you to do, but if you pay attention and take their ideas to Carson City and share them with your constituents up there and your fellow legislators up there, I think that's the key.
What are you hearing that they're most concerned about?
You know, I haven't heard one common thread, one common issue. Healthcare is always something. We're talking about roads. We've talked a little bit about roads and some of those kinds of things, but really nothing other than that at this point in time.
Walmart held their annual Shop with a Cop last weekend.
It was fun. It was cool to see her like run around and just be happy and stuff. So
I had real fun. I got a pair of high heels. I got some, I got a cool box that's all sparkly.
So she got to pick out some items. I know she said some high heels and some sparkly things.
Yeah, she picked out some shoes, some makeup, and a Barbie of some sort. I'm not really sure.
Have you ever done this before?
No, this is my first time, actually.
Do you hope to do this in the future?
Oh, absolutely. This was amazing. This was a fun time. So.
Walmart said that they sent out a whole bunch of emails and people came back very quickly volunteering for this.
Yeah, it was. We really jumped on the opportunity to help out with Pahrump and just help out because it's just, you know, the holiday season and it's just.
Yeah. The officers at CCA seem to volunteer a lot here in the community.
Yeah, we're very community-driven. We like to support the community that we're in and let them know that we're here to help them and that just be good neighbors. So,
was it great to see her face when she got to pick out the items and kind of just go crazy?
Oh, absolutely. It was priceless.
It only just took a few minutes, though, didn't it, for her to actually spend the money?
Oh, yeah. She knew exactly what she wanted. So.
So much fun, that event. Bikers from all over came together for the annual Tribe Toy Drive held last Sunday. They delivered gifts to boys and girls all over Pahrump.
We're going to deliver toys to some of the needy and some of the people that are out of work and things today.
I know we've been doing this for years. How many years?
Since 1991.
And how many riders do we have today participating? I know it's not just the tribe.
We have the gents, we have the Vietnam vets, we have several groups coming out of Las Vegas, and we have a lot of independents. Everybody's welcome to come.
A lot of people donated for this. They donated toys, bikes, food.
Absolutely. We had doctor's offices and lawyers in Vegas, and we had people out here, all the community out here, helped to do that. And we had independent people just come down and buy bicycles and things like that. And we couldn't do it without the people. And some of them don't get to go on the run, but they always give.
How did we identify the families that we're donating to?
They call in to the coalition and things like that, and through different things that Pahrump sponsors and stuff, we get some information from them. And the most needy, we try to help.
Do you know how many families?
We got 22 on the run, and then I do right up till Christmas, so it's probably about 60 or 70. And then through the Oasis, we do people that are homeless and stuff that will be coming in and picking up boxes through the whole week. So I'd probably say maybe 200 people.
Are you still in need of donations?
Not after today. And Toys for Tots always helps us too. I want to put them in. And just different organizations. We've had from the DA's office to just different individuals, Inks, Automotive, just all, JMAR, all the bike places here. So
I know that this is really something that the riders come out to support. A lot of the clubs here support this wholeheartedly.
Yes, they come every year. If they don't make anything else, they make sure that they make the tribe Christmas run. And we support each other. We go to the gents' things. We go to the Vietnam vets. They'll have their event and stuff. And so we support back and forth. The independents are a large group, too. They help us in this. And then people just in general, you know, we have cars, vans, everything else that go around because it's what the spirit of Christmas is all about.
Deanna's little, in there. We're going to have more with News 46's Week in Review, so better keep it here.
Harum's most watched and number one media source for local news and weather with Deanna O'Donnell.
Welcome back to News 46. Butch Harper gave an Act of Kindness Award to a special town hero.
The award is an act of kindness, and the award is actually for people that goes above and beyond an act of kindness. And Dan here performed an act that went above and beyond. And
even before the structure fire happened, he was already nominated, wasn't he?
Yes, he was. I got his name, and... So I thought of an idea that have an Act of Kindness Award, and that's people that goes beyond and above an act of kindness, and what Dan did. And I want to make this one point. I don't want any of you people trying to do what Dan did, because Dan had over 20-some years experience in firefighting. So don't let your emotions cloud your mind and try to do what he did, because you might create two problems. And you got loved ones that want to see you the next day, so let's use your head. When the fire department comes there too, get out of the way. Let them have room. And again, I can't stress it enough. Do not try to do what Dan did. Don't let your emotions carry over. So this award that I thought of, and I want to thank Vern and Channel 46 for allowing me to do this, because they've done an awful lot for the community. But at this time, I would like to present this award, Act of Kindness Award, to Dan Mullick. And on the bottom it says, an act of kindness is never wasted. So there's people that has to be noticed in this town, whether they embarrass or they don't want that publicity. They get what they got right here in the heart. But sometimes you got to recognize people, and Dan is one of those people. And I hope this is one of many awards that will be given out for people that go above and beyond. So, Dan, I'd like to give you this award.
Thank you.
And I want to shake your hand. It's a privilege to be able to do this.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
And later in the broadcast, you, of course, see that Cheyenne structure fire. We do want to give an update on the female that was involved in that. She is in UMC Trauma Center in critical condition. And, of course, we appreciate everything that Dan did there. But one of the people that I really think needs one of those awards would be Butch Harper.
Absolutely. It's so ironic how he's out there giving these awards to everybody else and trying to find people who deserve them. Exactly. Should look right at home.
Exactly. Yeah. He's a wonderful man. And, of course, we'll be giving more of those awards as people commit acts of kindness.
Definitely. And there's so many here in our community.
Really?
Well, Linda DeMayo is inviting, she's another one, everyone to the Christmas dinner at the Nye Communities Coalition Building on Christmas Eve.
This Saturday from 1 to 3 at the Nye Community Coalition Building on West and Wilson Street is going to be the Christmas Community Dinner. We're going to speak to Linda DeMay.
It's going to be from 1 to 3 like we normally do our holiday dinners at the same place, which is the new Coalition Building, which is the Old Man's School on Wilson and West Street.
This is going to be a fun event. We decided to make it the day before because of church, I think, for on Sunday.
We have so many pastors and people that work in their churches that's why we said, okay, we'll be willing to do it on Christmas Eve. Because as you know, I prefer the day of. Yeah. But it would be too stressful for the Coalition Holiday Task Force Committee to do this. And I didn't want to put all that strain on them.
Exactly. How many people are participating and helping out with this Christmas dinner?
Well, the coalition consists of about 20 people. That's the, and then I have a small committee of volunteers. That's four people. I have three Lindas and a Shonda. It's Linda Chapman, Linda, we call her Linda BK, Linda DeMeo, and Shonda Wayland. So it's an interesting group of people. And so they're, anybody who wants to volunteer, there's going to be an orientation at the Coalition Building Friday, which is tomorrow, at 10 a.m. And the two Lindas and a Shonda are working on that.
There you go. And so that would help out all the volunteers to get this event prepared and ready to go. How are we doing on the permits to have cooking in that facility?
Being that everything is catered in, we do not need any special permits because we're under the umbrella of the coalition. Yeah. So the prison is doing 12 turkeys. Mm-hmm. Saddle West is doing 16 turkeys. Terrible's Lakeside is doing 10 turkeys and a bunch of turkey legs.
Wow.
And then, of course, the Homestead Cafe is doing the side orders. Irene's, through U.S. Foods, has donated two hams, and then we're getting the rest of the hams from Irene's. And then the Surplus Store on 372 donated 14 hams, I understand.
Wow.
And all the people have donated just all the sides and the food, and it has been an amazing, amazing holiday season for the Holiday Task Force. It's been awe-inspiring and mind-blowing.
For more information, you can give Linda DeMeo a phone call at 209-4683. Merry Christmas to everyone. This is Deanne O'Donnell at Slater Trudeau for News 46.
That's going to be a great event. Remember, once again, that's Saturday from 1 to 3, not on Sunday as usual. We normally have them on the actual holiday. The Positive Prump Facebook Toy Drive is now an annual event. We caught up with Stephanie Lopez and Dustin Knutson.
There's 35 families right now. I think we totaled out to like 99 kids on the first list of families. And then the overall total is still yet to be determined, but it's somewhere in the range of about, I would say, almost 200 kids with the angel trees that we've done as well. So,
How did it work on the Facebook?
We just basically been advertising, sharing events. Most other people are sharing on their pages. And like I said, it's going pretty well today.
Do we have a list? A list for the kids of what they wanted to get for Christmas?
Yes, there's actually a list. Stephanie actually made it to where the kids can have the opportunity to make a sort of a wish list of what they might want for Christmas, and each of them put about three items on the list of what they want, you know, from, you know, the most wanted toy to, you know, just the most practical toy. So they've all been really decent. Like we said, a lot of clothes. You got the ones that are asking for toys, just a wide variety of toys for kids from age 0 to 17. So
tell me, I know that we discussed this before, but how did we identify these kids?
They would send me a message through Facebook, and I would, you know, speak to their families or their parents and just get an idea on why they're struggling or why they need assistance, and then go from there.
How did the teenagers go? How did that go this year?
This year was hard because last year we didn't have quite as many teenagers. This year we've had a lot of 17-year-olds. Mm-hmm. And I've told Dustin, I think everybody deserves Christmas. Mm-hmm. So it's cost us a little bit more, but it's worth it to us.
So we won't be continuing this after today. Will we be doing this again next year?
Absolutely. And I plan on making it bigger. So I would like an angel tree at every school in the district and then do what we can for the rest of the families.
Who do we have to thank?
We have a list. Artesia Residents, P-Town Air, Valley Electric, Saida, Tomp Rank Builders, Big O Tires, Edward Holmes, Morales Construction, Stovall Associates, Front Valley Auto Plaza.
Tim Hafen, the ASO Soccer Foundation, the Front Valley Firefighters Union, Satellite Systems, Ron Kent, Advantage Self Storage, Spring Mountain Racetrack, Front Valley Recycling, L&S Landscape, and then we also have Shenanigans here in town as well that have donated too.
We have Mom's Diner, Smith's, Walmart, Little Caesars, Domino's, Subway, A&A Masonry, and Threads, and Dairy Queen.
And how can people keep up to date on everything that's going on Positive Prump?
They could go on my page on Positive Prompt, but like I said, there's posts all over a lot of people's sites. So,
firefighters were busy, but luckily not for the usual reasons. They made a lot of people happy with deliveries all over town.
Every year we take donations for Toys to Tots, and the wonderful men and women of the Pahrump Fire Department come and take them and distribute them to everywhere they need to go. Oh no, the majority of the gifts that were donated were given by the clients. They're very generous people, very good people of the community, so yeah.
Wonderful. I know that you guys have a Halloween party and a Christmas party every year.
Absolutely. It's a good time. You know, just like I said, lots of singing, lots of dancing, having a good time and getting to know one another.
We filled up the whole fire truck, the portion. What portion is that with?
Well, we filled the cab, and we also filled the back of the hazmat truck and the cab of the hazmat truck. So it's quite a few. It looked like we robbed Santa Claus.
Pahrump Valley Farm Rescue also went to the senior center this morning.
We were out there delivering Christmas dinners throughout the community to seniors that may not necessarily be out to get to the community center today.
Pahrump Valley Fire Department is delivering for our Christmas dinners. And the cooperation of those two units, it's extraordinary. We are very, very pleased with their cooperation. They do a great service for the community.
It was really neat to see how everybody pitched in the community center and to provide all the dinners and the stockings and all the things for people who can't quite get out. So.
I just want to show you just some of the volunteers that came out to assist us today. They're always in the background. I want to make sure that the people know that they're out there serving our community, not only on the structure fire that occurred earlier today, but also helping with the the Christmas dinner deliveries, as well as the delivery of these gifts today. So I just want to say thank you to them as well.
Don't go anywhere. News 46's Week in Review will return in just a moment.
Pahrump's most watched and number one media source for local news and weather with Deanna O'Donnell.
Welcome back to News 46. A two-story stick-built home on Calvary Street caught fire last weekend, and the cause appears to be because the wrong material was being burned inside the home's fireplace.
It was two-story, single-family dwelling. Upon arrival, we had fire showing a division roof, and our investigation revealed that we had an attic fire. The interior conditions were pretty good, allowed crews to get up to the second floor without any problems. Once they accessed in the attic area, they found heavy fire conditions in the area where the chimney was mounted. It appears through the investigation that there was some inappropriate materials being burned in the fireplace, which then caused a fire condition within the chimney extending to the primary structure.
We called hazmat on scene?
No, there was no hazmat last night or anything like that. It was one of our units that responded, but it wasn't anything related to a hazmat call.
And how much of the dwelling do you know got destroyed in that?
There was a number of roof rafters and ceiling joists in the area between the second floor ceiling and the roof that had fire damage, and in the area of the wood frame fireplace that ran the entire length of the second story.
And we had a person up on the roof trying to put out the fire, the homeowner?
This is one of those challenges that we talked about just recently, is that people trying to take the actions, and what we're investigating on this is the probability that there was an extreme delay in notification by the occupant trying to suppress the fire on their own. And it caused not only a life safety issue for that person, but it also delayed our response, which could have culminated a lot larger or much more damage to the structure itself.
Are we looking at possible charges or arrests for people who are interfering with the rescue and firefighting efforts?
There are actually both state laws and town ordinances that people can be arrested and fined for such actions. And we're pleading to the community so that we don't have to do that. But in some cases, you know, it may become necessary. Maybe that might be something that we have to do on a regular basis if they're interfering, because it's ultimately hurting them. Yeah.
Because they're actually, what they're doing is delaying you guys fighting that fire.
Not only delaying, but the response. And then once we arrive on location, delaying the suppression objectives.
The best thing to do in a fire is that you have a fire, even if it's a small fire, do not try to fight it.
Call 911 and evacuate it. Go to a safe area. Report to us. As soon as we arrive, we want to know everyone's out of the structure. That way we can get away from the life safety aspect and go right to suppression.
And as we told you earlier in the broadcast, one woman was critically injured in a structure fire on Cheyenne Street on the south of town this past Monday. We speak to Fire Chief Scott Lewis.
Just after 8 o'clock this morning, we were dispatched for a report of a structure fire with heavy smoke showing. Valley Electric happened to be operating in the area. They arrived very quickly, started securing the power, and in that process, they gave an updated report that, in fact, we did have a structure. Upon my arrival, we found a single-family, a mobile home, well-involved, with advanced fire throughout. We also found a person that had been removed by some bystanders laying down in the driveway, has sustained some serious burns, as well as smoke inhalation. We went into the objective of life safety for her protection. Objective of suppression was the immediate structure as well as the exposure structures that are all attached here. As you can see, there's a number of structures on the property, and also to bring Mercy Air in for patient care.
The person was airlifted to UMC Trauma Center via Mercy Air for what you just said, those injuries. Was there somebody else on scene here too as well?
There were several people. I'm not sure exactly. One was Dan Malowitz, who I know from the search and rescue days.
I was in the kitchen looking out the back window, seeing a whole bunch of smoke coming up, which was unusual for Maggie's house, and called it in, came around, and started pounding on the doors and everything, knowing that she's probably a late sleeper, and finally found her standing halfway in the house, standing up looking for her dog. Being an ex-firefighter, I crawled on the floor, grabbed her by the legs, pulled her down, and dragged her out, and started first aid on her.
He was on scene, and it was a few other people at the time. Dynamics were a little out of the ordinary upon our arrival. Sheriff's officers assisted us in taking care of that situation because it actually distracted from what our main goals and objectives were. But it was handled timely by the sheriff's office, and as you can see, the fire's under control. We're in an investigative phase now, and we've summoned the assistance from the Deputy State Fire Marshals en route from Las Vegas.
You had a person that wanted to try to save a vehicle who was kind of disrupting the scene.
There was attempts to save an older style vehicle that was parked in close proximity. And again, considering the fact that we had immediate life safety issues in the initial stages, the property is secondary. And so once the life safety was pretty much squared away with our paramedics, then we could focus on making sure that other property wasn't damaged, and that vehicle was subsequently pulled out with some minor damage to the front.
How much does that disrupt the firefighters and the rescuers to have a person running around trying to save things or trying to put out fires on their own? You guys have to refocus your attention.
It's extremely disruptive, and I encourage everyone just to leave the fire grounds. That way you know everyone's safe. When people run back into structures for personal property, we then have to refocus from a suppression objective, which is what they want us to do, back to a life safety objective. We have to make sure everybody is safe. And one of the things that we need to do is we have an action area, which includes where the apparatus is operating and the fire grounds itself. Everybody's got to step back out of that area. That way we know how we're going to conduct and complete our objectives and goals and make sure everybody's safe at the same time.
That same person was laying on the ground in the middle of the street at one point. Is he injured?
He's not injured from this incident. It may be something pre-existing, but he's declined any medical assistance.
And as well, Dan was injured in the life-saving rescue there.
Well, it's my understanding that he may have received some abrasions to his hands. They've been evaluated by the EMS on scene, and it appears that he does not want to be treated or transported.
Do we know if the woman who was trying to find her dog inside the structure, if the dog was rescued? Or?
I have no word on that at this point. We're still in the investigative phase. As we said, it's a single family. We're protecting it for the investigation. All the bulk fire has been knocked down, and it's just a matter of preserving it.
Did we get additional structures involved here?
It extended to a carport and was going to the primary residence, but that was quickly halted by the first arriving crews.
Well, that's all, folks, for News 46's Week in Review. Some of the weekend events include, of course, that community Christmas dinner that we told you about there at the Knight Community Coalition building on West and Wilson Street. Remember, once again, that is not on Sunday. It is on Saturday from 1 to 3. And we wanted to say a very Merry Christmas to everybody.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Everybody say Merry Christmas. This is Aaron, by the way. It's Zach's brother. He's operating the camera. We want to thank him very much. And, of course, Nathan Hollenbeck up there doing the master control for the first time. Good job, Nate. And that's it for this edition of News 46. We'll see you next week. Have a very Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to all. Everyone. Peace, love, and happiness.
And Mrs. Claus said it all. Merry Christmas, Knight County. Merry Christmas, Pahrump. And thank you all. And you have a wonderful holiday. And Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. And I'll see you next year.
Thank you.
Ho, ho, ho. Merry Christmas, Pahrump. Remember, little kids, you can always send me letters to P.O. Box 133, Pahrump, Nevada, 89048, in care of Santa Claus. Ho, ho, ho. Merry Christmas to all.
Hi, it's Karen from KNYE Radio. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
Hi, I'm Gary Hollis, and I want to wish everyone a Merry, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. I'm Dan Shinofen, and have yourselves a safe holiday.
My name is Mike Dreher. I'm with the Pahrump Valley Chamber of Commerce. On behalf of the Pahrump Valley Chamber of Commerce Board of Directors and staff, we would like to wish everybody a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Ho, ho, ho. Merry Christmas to Olive Pahrump from the Waterstone Bunch. Happy holidays.
Hi, I'm Mitzi Sears. I'm representing BJ, the Nevada Silver Tappers, and the Senior Golden Years USA Queens Court. I just want to thank you for this opportunity to say Merry Christmas to each and every one of you.
I'm Vicki Gladstone, Miss Senior Golden Years 2011, wishing you a happy holiday and a Merry Christmas. Thank you.
Hi folks, I'm Tom Saida, and this time of the year I want to wish everyone Merry Christmas and Happy Hanukkah and certainly Happy New Year. We hope the best for all of you.
Hi, this is Bill Koberger.
Matt Lewis.
And from the town of Pahrump, we both wish you a very Merry Christmas.
Ho, ho, ho! You're watching KPVM. Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas!
Carl Moore, wanted to wish everybody a happy holidays. Have the best this year. Thank you very much.
Just want to wish you a happy holidays from the whole Terribles crew and make sure it's a safe one. Thank you.
Hi, Merry Christmas. This is Julie Hargis. Just want to say happy holidays from Car Studio and Pahrump Mobile Detailing and wishing you all well in the new year and happy health and good tidings to all. Thank you.
Merry Christmas to everybody in Pahrump, Las Vegas, and the whole of the United States.
Merry Christmas and Happy New Year from all of us at KPVM. Yay! Yay!